Yeah, now let's look at the usage of some of the common finance functions. Of course, these are not targeted towards anyone who is a finance professional, or this has nothing to do with that kind of background. But the most common things as a part of our day-to-day investments, like let's say if I deposit something today, how much will I get after some time? Right, some FDs or normal investments which we typically do, or if I take a loan for some 20 lakhs and this is the interest rate, how much EMI should I need to pay? So those are the typical kind of functions which we typically will try to do as a part of this session. So as far as these kind of calculations are concerned, these kind of computations are concerned, there are a few queries, there are a few formulas, right? What I'll do is I'll create a few queries which are more relating to finance functions. Like if I deposit 1,000 today for 5 years at 10% per annum, compounded quarterly, how much is received after 5 years? One question, which is a very common kind of a question. Two, if I take a loan of 20 lakhs for 20 years at 11% per annum interest, how much EMI should I need to pay? So these are typically the very common questions which we come across. But what we observe in all these things is, to address these kind of questions relating to I deposit something, I get something in future, or if someone promises me some money in future, how much do I need to deposit today? Or sometimes some kind of investments will be more like every year you deposit something, at the end of 5 years or 10 years you will get some lump sum money. So these are the regular kind of basic investment mechanisms which we come across. Now, these kind of queries, see, typically when I approach a bank to file some FD, they say some interest rate, and finally they say this is the amount which you are going to get. How do I verify it out? Probably is that customer service executive giving me that exact number of the interest which I am getting or not? If it is a 5 year interest compounded quarterly, how much I should get, right? Because sometimes there may be some hidden charges. They may simply take out 100 rupees for processing. They may say 9.5% interest, but finally when you see how much you will get after 5 years, you may get something reduced. So to understand that, it's better to put these kind of things in a formula, so that though sometimes they don't speak out, once you put it up, they like actually explain, okay, this 100 rupees is deducted for this charge, something for something else. So finally what you are getting is probably 0.25% less than what they are saying. So it's better to understand these kind of aspects by putting into these kind of formulas. Now, coming down to the Excel, these kind of regular investment stuff, they are handled through 5 formulas, and they are actually 5 fields in themselves. So there is a definition called PV, which is typically called as present value, which is more like today's value, either deposited or received, right? Today's value, either paid or received. If I deposit 1,000 today, means I have paid 1,000 today. I have taken a loan of 20 lakhs today, means I have received 20 lakhs. So whatever is happening today as a lump sum, as a one-time payment or received, I have treated as a part of PV. Then there is one more thing called FV, which is future value, which is like in future, let's say after 5 years, how much am I going to get or pay, payment or receipt in at a future date in lump sum after some years. That is what we call as FV. Then we also have something called PMT, which is sometimes we have a scenario of recurring payments, like EMI is like a recurring payment. Every month I have to pay same amount. So if there is an equal amount to be paid at, paid or received at equal intervals of time, I treat that as a part of PMT. If something is lump sum, I treat it in PV or FV. PV is today, FV is sometime in future, but it's lump sum. But if it is more of a recurring payment of same amount, let's say insurance premiums, they are like recurring payments of the same amount. Every year I pay the same premium. EMIs, recurring payment of same amount. Every month I'll pay the same EMI. So those kind of numbers, I treat them under the PMT heading, which is like a payment, but regular recurring kind of a payment. Then I also have one more field called rate, which is the interest rate. Right? Typically we call this as periodic rate. I don't call it as annual interest or quarterly interest. Depending on what is our objective, I'll use that particular rate. If EMI is my objective, I'll use a monthly interest rate. If I'm depositing every quarter, then I'll use quarterly interest rate, like that. Then NPER is one more field to be used, which is number of periods. Again, it's not number of years, right? These three should be of the same period. When I say that there is a recurring payment, what is the frequency? Quarterly? If I say quarterly is the recurring frequency, then the rate should be a quarterly rate. Then number of periods should be number of quarters. All should be in quarters. When I say EMI, the payment is monthly, the rate should be monthly rate, and period NPER should be number of months. That's the kind of a logic, right? But in some cases, if there is no PMT, no recurring payment, only one lump sum payment, then at least these two should be in the same frequency. So let's look at the first question. If I deposit 1000 today, so what is 1000 here? Present value. 1000 is the present value. Because I am depositing it, it's a cash outgoing from my pocket. So I'll represent it with minus 1000. If a cash is coming to me, I'll represent it with plus. Cash going out, I represent it with minus. Okay, if I deposit 1000 today for 5 years, so NPER is 5. For 5 years at 10% per annum. So 10% per annum, the interest rate is 10%. But look at the next part, compounded quarterly. Which means the actual calculation is happening quarterly, not yearly. So which means these two needs to be changed into quarters. So this should be a quarterly rate. How much is the, if 10% is per year, per quarter it is 2.5%. Right, 10% is per the year. So divide by 4. So per quarter it is 2.5%. Similarly, if 5 years, number of quarters is 20. So per year there are 4 quarters, per 5 years there are 20 quarters. So NPER will become 20. If I don't make that change, I'll get different numbers. Probably let's try that out also. How much I receive after 5 years. So which means there is no PMT in this case. Recurring payment. I am not depositing 1000 every year or every quarter. I have just deposited 1000 for 5 years. But if the question says, if I deposit 1000 every quarter, then I will not put 1000 here, I will put minus 1000 here. If the question is, if 1000 is deposited every quarter, then how much will I get after 5 years? Instead of saying, if I am depositing 1000 today as one lump sum, if I say 1000 every quarter, repeated payment of 1000, then I will put that 1000 in PMT, not under PV. PV is like one lump sum payment or received. PMT is more like recurring payment or received. Right? Every period, every quarter, same amount. Every month, same amount. So EMIs are actually handled here. EMIs are any insurance premiums I am paying, which is not a one-time payment. It's like a recurring payment. Those things I handle them as a part of PMT. Now I have to calculate FP here because the question is asking how much is received after 5 years. There is a one lump sum which I am going to receive after 5 years. So I have to find out what is FP. The good thing is these five are five different formulas. So equal to FP will give me a future value formula, equal to PV, equal to PMT, whatever it is. One of these five, if I want to find out, I just need to say equal to that name. And the remaining four are inputs to that. So they are like interlinked like this. Remaining four will be there in any kind of a question. Right. If you have to find out the fifth one, you will have the information regarding the remaining four. Even for our loan example, we'll see. Even there also, you will have four. So, four will definitely be available. Only the fifth one you have to try out. Right. Now, I have to find out the FP. So, use equal to FP. Shift F3. Now, you see what are the questions he is saying. Rate, so pointed to this, NPER pointed to this, PMT pointed to this, PV pointed to this. Type you can ignore for time being. So you, all the remaining four are available, so you just point them to those numbers. Now it is simply saying you will get 1638.62 after 5 years. Right, if the compounding is happening quarterly, probably write it down somewhere, 1638.62. Now, in case I have missed out this aspect of quarterly and I have just taken annual 10% and for 5 years. So, if I say put the rate as 10% here and 5 here, I am getting only 1610. The answer is differing. If it is annual compounding, it comes to me only as 1610. But because this is quarterly, I am getting 1638. Right? So sometimes, even on this, we may be cheated. Right? Because there is a quarterly compounding, I should get something more. But I may be said that I will get only this much. If this is for 1000 rupees, we are getting some 28 difference. Obviously, for 10,000 rupees, you will get. This also will be increased by 10. So, 16,386, 16,105. almost 280 rupees difference is coming out, which will have a big impact, right? So that's where understanding this is a very important aspect. So finding out the future value based on the present value, the rate of interest, and the number of periods. Again, the number of periods and rate should be in synchronization. If I am talking of a quarterly compounding, a quarterly interest rate should be looked at, and the period should be in number of quarters. Right? So this is how we address this question. Now, let's look at another example. If I take a loan of 20 lakhs for 20 years. So what are the numbers? 20 lakhs is what? I am receiving 20 lakhs today. So PV is 20 lakhs. Okay, plus 20 lakhs. I am receiving 20 lakhs today. So PV is plus 20 lakhs. For 20 years. So the number of periods is 20. At 11% per annum interest. So the interest rate is 11%. How much EMI should I need to pay? So actually this is what I have to compute. Now what about the FV? How much am I paying after 20 years? Zero, right? In this EMI mechanism, after 20 years, the entire amount is paid within the 20 years itself. So after 20 years, there is nothing. If someone says, no, you pay something like this and after 20 years you pay 50,000 or 1 lakh, then that's a different story. But in a normal EMI process, after the loan period, you are not paying anything. On the final day, you don't pay anything. Zero. Right? So now I have to find out the PMT, which is the EMI. But here, these two are important. Because this is monthly. I am computing EMI, which is monthly. But these two are per annums. So you convert them into monthlies. Even this has to be converted into monthly. So do it as 11% divided by 12. So that is the what? And the month, years, this is 20 years. Multiply it by 12 to make it 240 months. So all three should be in the same period. Otherwise, your calculations will go wrong. It will not match with what the banks and other organizations are computing it. Now, use the PMT formula equal to PMT, shift F3. Just see the other things are exactly the same. Rate, point to this. NPER, point to this. PV, point to this. FV, point to this. Now it says you have to pay 20,643 as the EMI. Right? You have to pay 20,643 as your EMI. If this is the interest rate and these many periods you have to pay, this will happen to be your EMI. Right? And now, you can very well play around. Oh, instead of 20 years, I want to go for 25 years loan. Change this to 25 into 12. 300 months. Right? Instead of 20 years, I want to go take a 25 year loan. So, what is the EMI? I have to pay 19,602 per month. Only a reduction of this 1,000 or something. Earlier it was 20,000 odd, now it is 19,000. So, extending the loan period is not reducing my EMI drastically. Right? I'm almost ending up paying almost a similar amount as my EMI. Instead of, let's say, I just want to pay within 10 years. $27,550 is coming out as the EMI. So, this is actually taking into consideration the compounding factors, And also, how the rates are vary. I mean, the more interest in the first period, less interest in the later periods, and all that kind of stuff. The reason being, initially, the interest is levied on the entire principal. But as it progresses, you keep paying some portion of the principal as a part of the EMIs. So as it moves towards the later, it actually reduces your interest amount and increases the principal contribution. Because at the end, you end up paying 27,550 every month. Right? Out of that 27,550, the interest is something, principal is something. How do I find out what is the interest and what is the principal? Let's say for some month, let's say for 100th month, I want to find out what is the principal, what is the interest of that 27,550. Here I will use formulas called PPMT and IPMT. PPMT is principal of the payment. IPMT is interest part of the payment. Right? Let's see for the, if I join these two, it should equal to that PMT. What? The principal portion plus interest portion, if I add up these two things, it should be equal to 27,550. Then only our calculation is correct for any month. Right? We'll try out few months. Okay, now we'll use PPMT equal to PPMT. All the things are more or less the same. The rate. This one. PER is actually the month for which you are computing the interest as well as principal. NPER is total number of months. NPER is total number of months. PER is for which month you are actually computing the principal and interest breakup. Because for each month, that breakup between the principal and interest will change. Though the total will be 27,550 only, the breakup between principal and interest will vary. So PER is more of that number. And for the 100th month, then NPER is coming from here. There are 120 months. PV is 20 lakhs and FV is 0. Now this says the principal portion is 22,745 in that month. Now look at the interest portion by going with IPMT. The rate is this one. The PER is this one. NPER is this one, PV, FV. The interest portion is 4,804 rupees. Now you just add up these two things. 27,550, which is the same as your total EMI. Out of your total EMI, your principal, I mean, in the 100th month, you are paying a principal of 22,745 and interest of 4,804. Right? Now, no, why not 100? Look at 50th month. In the 50th month, your principal is 14,000, interest is 13,000. Total is still 27,550 only. Fifth month, your principal is only 9,000, interest is 17,000. So what happens is, in the initial period, interest will be very high, and in the later periods, interest will almost go down, because every month, if I see first month, interest is 18,333, but you are paying 27,550. Which means the remaining 9,216 is actually going towards repayment of the principal. So for the next month, your principal is coming down. Your principal is coming down from 20 lakhs, it has reduced by 9,000. So So probably 1 lakh, 19 lakhs, 91,000 something. That is your principal. So for the next month, the interest will be only on 19 lakhs, 91,000, because you have paid back some portion of the principal. So that's how, because every month you are paying something in the form of principal, your principal is coming down every month. Right? I mean, the total outstanding principal is coming down every month, which is what is making your interest payment lesser for the next month. And but you are still paying 27,550. So a maximum contribution is going towards the principal repayment. Right?